we who are Christ's will be made alive at his presence. This includes his coming to the air for the believers of this economy. In other words, those who are members of the body of Christ today, they will meet Christ in the air, according to 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. And this also includes his coming to Israel before the 1,000 years. The rest who are not included in those who are Christ must wait until the consummation when death, the last enemy, is abolished. This will not occur until the eons have run their course and Christ hands over the kingdom to the Father.
Let's ask a simple question about death. Yeah. And about this immortality, this great verse in verse 26 of 1 Corinthians 15. The last, death is called the last enemy.
Yeah.
And it says there specifically that death, the last enemy, shall be abolished.
Mm.
Let me ask a simple question. If death is abolished, what else could possibly be left?
Do you want me to answer?
I do. I'm hoping you know, but otherwise my whole plan is screwed up here.
If death is abolished, the only thing that's left is life.
Is life. Now, if the abolition of death at the consummation is the thing that's going to make God all in all, as that verse says he's going to be, that means that those people become part of God's all in all by being alive. In other words, when he abolishes death, you have no other choice. Right now, we separate people between death and life. Jesus Christ is the only one that's alive today.
Right.
And in the kingdom, there's going to be many of the saints are going to raise. Peter's going to raise from the dead. And there's going to be a bunch
Abraham,
of people raised
Isaac, Jacob,
from
right.
the dead. But wait a minute, listen to what I say. From the dead. So we're distinguishing there's some alive, some dead, some
right.
alive, some dead. Now it's easy. Everybody's dead except for Jesus Christ, except those of us who are living on this earth. But I mean, as far as those who have, quote, died, I mean, those who have died, Jesus Christ is the only one who's alive. Now, at the kingdom, when Christ returns to set up the 1,000 years, a giant resurrection is going to take place. Daniel prophesied concerning it, called the former resurrection. But there's still going to be a lot of people dead because Revelation 20, I think it is, verse 5 says, the rest of the dead do not live until the 1,000 years are finished.
Correct.
So all through the Aeonian times, we see more people becoming alive, people becoming dead. Some are dead, some are alive. And you can really divide people by that standard. He's alive now. He's dead. He's in the kingdom. He's not. Where is he? He's in the second death. At the great white throne, we have the second death.
Mm-hmm.
Many people are going to be raised at the great white throne. Then they're going to go to the second death. We're going to be alive during that time. But there's going to be a time coming when you won't be able to make those distinctions anymore because everybody's going to be alive. Why? Because of the simple fact in 1 Corinthians 15:26 that death is abolished.
Right.
So at that point, there's no question as to where you are now. Here's where we get back to the church sign and what path are you on? Okay, I said that there's nowhere in the Bible that says you have eternal life. That would be stupid because eternity, when death is abolished, there's nothing but life. So it's a redundancy to say that for eternity you're going to live. That's a redundancy if God's going to be all in all because death is abolished. It's redundant. What we need to know is who's going to be alive while these other people are dead. You see what I mean?
Right.
If you have Aeonian life instead of eternal life, Aeonian life, life that goes through these eons, that's a much more amazing thing than eternal life. Everybody has eternal life. That's why that church sign that says, where will you spend eternity? Stupid question.
That's right.
Everybody spends eternity with God because death is abolished, 1 Corinthians 15:26.
Right.
And God becomes all in all, 1 Corinthians 15:28. So the pertinent question is, where will you spend the eons? Now, I tell you, you have Aeonian life. That should mean so much more to you because now you have enough life to make it to a time where there's nothing but life. I say you have Aeonian life. Oh, no, that means I don't live with eternity, for eternity with God. No, it doesn't. It means that you have enough life to make it to a time when there's nothing but life.
Mm-hmm.
If you have enough water to make it to a well, I'm going to say, if I tell you I'm going to give you enough water to make it to the well, do you bitch about it?
No.
No, why? Because you're going to get to the well where there's nothing but water. As long as you have enough water to get to that well, you're in good shape. Now, I'm telling you, you have Aeonian life. Oh, no. I'm going to die someday. No, you have enough life to make it to a time when there's nothing but life. Aeonian life does not rob you of immortality.
No.
It just tells you that you have so much more than these other people who are dead during these other time periods.
But Martin, what about all the unbelievers? Isn't God going to punish them for
yes.
all their sins?
Well, no, he's going to judge them. He's not going to punish them. This is a good point. You brought up a good point.
I know.
There is a day of reckoning.
There
is weeping. And there is gnashing of teeth.
Yes.
And there is judgment. And Mr. Sheridan and I believe in every single judgment in the Scripture.
But God's judgments are not punitive.
That's right. They're remedial.
They're
Listen
remedial.
To our vocabulary.
Is, aren't we
punitive
smart?
Punitive versus remedial.
Let me go get a dictionary.
Whew, we don't know what the heck we're...
God's judgments are for a purpose.
Yes.
They are to bring man... And one of the great lessons in the Scriptures is that God is going to humble the sons of humanity. One of the great purposes in the eons is that all mankind become humble.
Excellent point. He's doing that to us now.
And he's doing that to us now. And unbelievers who live and die without Christ are going to be judged. And it's going to be part of the humbling process to eventually to bring them back to God. But even an unbeliever today, he's going to be judged. He's going to be exterminated.
Yeah, we believe that.
We believe in the literal judgments of God that are coming on this earth, but we deny and we stand against the Plato philosophy and the Dante philosophy that makes this underworld judgment, which is unscriptural, unbiblical, and is a satanic lie.
That's why it's so important to get this word Aeonian right. This Greek word Aeonian, which the proper translation is Aeonian. It's almost a transliteration. Aeonian, Aeonian.
And we got to ask the question, though, where did this term eternity come from?
We'll get into that.
We got to let people know here that most of these translations come from traditional teachings. And all these translations were done by professional scribes, professional clergymen, and that is going to color their translation.
If you have Aeonian life, gosh, I knew I was balanced on that rail so thin, I forgot what I was going to say.
Sorry.
That's all right. You were going on about those clergymen. I'm thinking, hang on to it, Martin, hang on to it.
Hang on, and you lost and it.
Yeah, I lost
Where did
it. Oh, wait a minute. We were talking about how important it is, that translation. This
yes.
is why it's important to translate Aeonian, Aeonian. Because now, The big objection people have is, well, if you say, I don't have eternal life, how dare you? That means I don't live forever. No. We're saying that Aeonian life means you have enough life to make it to a time when there's nothing but life. So now that I've established that Aeonian life does not rob you of living forever with God, look what else the proper translation of this word does. For instance, Matthew 25 talks about the sheep and the goats. These will go into eternal
life
and these into eternal punishment. Now, if you correct this word, it also corrects the false idea people have about judgment. Now, the judgment is Aeonian, and God's discipline is Aeonian, and death becomes Aeonian. Don't freak out over that word again. It's in the Bible. It's in the New Testament over 175 times.
And I'll read it in the Concordant Literal, Matthew 25, and these shall be coming away into chastening Aeonian, yet the just into life Aeonian.
And that is a good translation. And
That's
the Concordant
right.
version is not the only one that translates it that way.
Young's
literal translation,
Rotherham,
the Rotherham Emphasized Bible. And if you look in the Greek, that word is there.
Yeah.
We're backing ourselves up. If it's not in the Scriptures, we can't believe it.
Yeah, well, you know, there's a couple Greek dictionaries out there and lexicons, and every one of them will admit that the word Aeonian is limited time, but they always come back and say it means eternity.
Well, that's because they're seeing these passages where we're promised eternal life, and they freak out because
they
say, well, that means I'm not going to live forever.
Now, here's the question.
It does not mean that.
Do you think those Crossway people, those pastors who say you have to repent and obey the rest of your life, do you think they have Aeonian life?
I don't.
What does one have to do to get Aeonian life today?
Well, it's a very subtle lie of Satan. These guys are trusting in their trust. They're trusting in their trust in
Jesus.
How
about this? Why don't we give them the gospel, shall we? To our friends at Crossway, we're concerned about you.
Yes, we are.
And we don't want to see you live any more in your deception and your lies. So here's the good news. You ready for the good news? I give over to you among the first, which I also accepted, that Christ died for our sins, according to the Scriptures, and that he was entombed, and that he has been roused the third day, according to the Scriptures. That's the good news.
And only God can cause you to believe it. It's not faith in your faith. It's faith in our Lord Jesus Christ.
And his accomplishments.